stand up when we're talking for our seats. Maybe I can speak up over the fan a little bit, and I don't know, I better leave it on for now, but just maybe speak up a bit. So welcome. It's great to see everyone here tonight. My name is Deborah Keisch. I'm a member of the Public Schools Action Coalition. Before we start, I just want to point out that there's some handouts on the table as you're leaving to grab that sort of describe some of the issues that we're talking about in a little more depth. We also, PSAP also has a website, which is, well, all right, well, I'll look that up and get that out to the end. I can't think of it off the top of my head. And we also have a listserv, so if you're interested in being on the listserv, then please let a PSAP member know while you're here that we need to distribute information. So before we begin, I just want to tell you a little bit about PSAP. So we're a group of local parents, teachers, school staff, who have come together really just about a year, not even a year ago, to address issues of equity and to work toward greater equity in our schools. So some of the issues that we've worked on so far have included trying to ensure that every student receives a hot lunch here in the district, trying to address issues of the impact, around the impact of high-stakes testing, which we feel, which we have taken a stance against the high-stakes nature of testing. And we also are concerned with the funding that goes to charter schools out of our district. So just some of the issues to give you a sense of what we work on. Our group is not unique. There are coalitions like ours popping up across the state and across the country to address very similar issues. So our most recent focus and what brings us here tonight is the devastating impact of high-stakes testing on our students and our teachers and our schools. So currently, this is taking the form of a Common Core state standard and a PARC test, which are the associated tests with the Common Core. So last week, there was a vote put to the school committee on whether or not to adopt the PARC test just for next year. So it was a 1 year, or we're going to keep the MCAT for 1 year. And our school committee voted to not move forward with the PARC test. And we feel, and PSAP, certainly that this opens up some room for us to begin a community conversation about what PARC is, about the impact of high-stakes testing. And I think what we have come to understand is not everyone feels like they really know what PARC is and what Common Core is. And so this is kind of the first of what we hope can be many conversations where we begin to explore these issues with our school committee members and with the community. And so, on that note, I wanted to introduce Kelsey Lynn, who is going to be our moderator tonight, past local radio DJ and news reporter, future parent of two Northampton Public School students, and very good friend. So, Kelsey.
Hi, everybody. I'm really just so thrilled to be a part of this discussion and to be here and so on. Thank all of you for taking the time out of your family time on a Wednesday night. So first want to recognize our school committee members are here. We have Ann Hennessy, Pam Hannah, and Amy Ball, and Andrew Shelmo here, and Lisa Minnick. There you are. Okay. And Lisa. And Howard, too. Howard Moore. So thank you very much for being part of this. And then Deborah, of course, is a member of PSAC, but if other members of PSAC could raise your hands, too, that would be great for them. To know who to go to as well, to get more information after the fact, to get on the listserv and that. So here's how it's going to be. And then it's, you asked me. I'm starting to jump. And but we're a good friend. So I can't talk to her like that. Yeah, I'm probably too. here's how we, how PSAC had planned this evening. I have three questions that they provided to me, and I will read them and one at a time. And for the school committee members who are here, it's not about whether you have a formal position to answer that question or not. It's really what are your feelings around that question? You have questions in answer to that question. So it's really just about conversation and dialogue and you know, no debate happening here, and so really just speaking from your heart about these particular questions. After the school committee members have had their chance to speak, and you don't have to speak to each question, so please just feel moved to speak when you feel moved. After, though, for each question, Camille Hammack, right over there, member of PSAC, she will answer the questions with PSAC's position on that. So we'll have this dialogue for the three questions for about an hour. It'd be great if we could wrap that portion of the conversation up around 8 o'clock so that there's a half hour for questions, just open questions from everyone here for the school committee members, for PSAC, and just for everyone's chance to find out more about this pretty important issue for us. So, we do have some common guidelines, kind of ground rules here. We'll bring them to everyone's attention. So we've got at the front is, that's nice. Assume goodwill here tonight with everybody. Respect differing perspectives. Commit to the spirit of inquiry. Step up or step back. So if you notice that you are kind of speaking a lot, notice that and maybe step back so that other folks have an opportunity to speak. And at the same time, if you feel like you are not and you want to, I just encourage you to take this time to ask the questions. This is a really important space and group that we've brought together, so now's the time. And commit to authentic listening. So as I understand that, it's really listening, and this is hard for me because it means listening and not trying to think of what you're going to say while someone else is speaking. So those are our guidelines that I will put back here for everyone. Is that everything, Deborah?
Yes.
Very good. All right. So we'll start with the first question, which is, so, Northampton School Committee, do you feel that the Common Core State Standards and the Associated High State Test, PARC, can address the so-called achievement gap, and do you feel they are in line with the mission of the Northampton Public Schools? So I'm going to read the mission. The mission of the Northampton Public Schools, in partnership with parents, guardians, and the Northampton community, is to promote and support high achievement by each student in a safe, healthy, secure environment, and to enable each student to become a critical thinker and a socially responsible citizen in a global society. So I'll read that again, the question again. Do you feel that the Common Core State Standards and the Associated High State Test PARC can address the so-called achievement gap, and you feel they're in line with the mission?
No.
No. For me, I feel like the research is so clear. The crucial issue is how damaging this is, and I think, and I'll say briefly about the Common Core, I'm not necessarily opposed to Common Core, except that its imposition and its lack of resources associated with it, I'm actually opposed to, and I think it's lack of transparency, so I'm not really speaking about it, and then I have a little bit of an issue with the fact that the commissioner is on the board of PARC. And that isn't a conflict of interest, whereas I can't give my daughter's first grade teacher $50 and don't decide to that would be a conflict of interest. But more importantly, I think for this is that I think high stakes testing is really damaging to kids. And the very kids we're actually trying to help in addressing the achievement gap, I actually think it exacerbates the problem. So,
I'll
still a lot of what Nate says. I don't necessarily have a problem with the standards we find for, because there's a lot of good things in this.
Can you speak up a little bit?
The problem that I have is more with the testing part of it, which is one of the reasons why I voted to not do the park testing last year. I think it is unfair to a lot of kids. I'm a parent of two kids who I know are already struggling with the testing, and they're in lower grades. One is going to enter next year, so it becomes more of a problem. But I am also willing. So I guess I'll sum up. We're willing to say, testing bad. Common Core standards not so bad. But of course, there's a connection between those two that has to be developed. And I think that's the problem.
I gave this a lot of thought prior to coming tonight, and I really looked at the question. The so-called achievement gap. In Northampton, I don't believe that the achievement gap goes along the lines of STEM versus non-STEM. I believe it runs along socioeconomic lines. Mm-hmm. And the STEM students, last year, they made their YAP goals, they really achieved the powerful, they made those goals. And the students with the low income are the ones that didn't make the goals, and I think they need to address that. As far as testing goes, I've been against MCAS, and the reason I was against MCAS is because a lot of the, I believe, before, I have older children who also have a 12-year-old, so 20-something, so they've gone through it, and I've seen it. Announces them for MCAS. And the thing about MCAS is I think that a lot of teachers ended up teaching differently. They ended up having to teach to a test. And to me, that's rather rote. How good are you at spitting back out what you learned? PARC, on the other hand, from what I gather, is more in line with the Northampton mission statement. It was to become a critical thinker. And PARC is designed to, from what I gather, to take away what MCAS does. MCAS spits back out the answers. PARC is supposed to have teachers have them learn how to think critically, have the students learn how to think critically. So I think there's going to be some training that way. As far as high stakes testing all along, I wish we didn't have them. I mean, as far as one test to say this child graduates or doesn't graduate is not fair. It's not a fair assessment. However, on the other hand, we're not looking at just Northampton or even just Massachusetts. We're looking at our country. And there is an achievement gap in our country and from different states. We happen to be one in the state that's very high achieving, especially in Northampton, very, very high achieving. But other places, I do believe, we need to have some sort of standard to gauge where the students are. I mean, some countries over in Europe, they don't let kids move on. And if they get to the eighth grade, I believe, and they don't pass their high stakes test, then they're encouraged to go to trade schools, and they're just not allowed to move on. I mean, maybe I'm not saying that I agree with that, but I'm saying that we do need to have some way to test them. So, but I don't believe in one test being the end all be all.
On Thursday, I abstained from voting for MCAS or PARC because my stance is that I don't support high stakes testing. And I'm very new to all of this, and so I'm kind of judging education based on my son's experience in preschool and the incredible ways that he has learned this year. And that would really answer the question. I don't think that there could be one test that could measure what people know. Maybe I'm naive, but students still receive report cards, and the teachers are assessing what they're doing. And so why are we not trusting our teachers to assess children and what they're seeing in the classroom? So I feel like there are bigger forces at work with do the test. If I was trying to explain to my son tonight where I was going and what I was going to be talking about, you know, I frame a lot of, you know, grown-ups are really confused. And there are grown-ups who think that you have to have sort of one test to kind of measure how people are doing. And that there are a series of grown-ups who are really interested in profit. They're really confused mm-hmm. and think that they have to just keep making more and more money. And I think that that is a lot of what is going on in the education. And I don't think it's going to, you know, I don't think these tests are going to impact the achievement gap. They're going to make it worse. They're not going to affect, you know, children who are unfortunate to grow up or to be born into families who are, you know, struggling in poverty or the struggling working class, or from, you know, children of color. And so we know that these are the groups that are most impacted. And so I know I'm encouraged to see everyone come out, and I think that we need all of our minds to put forth a vision of what our education system can be. Otherwise, we're going to keep sort of taking a defeated attitude that, like, well, you know, it's high-stakes testing, it's here to stay, there's really nothing we can do about it, let's just do the best we can. Mm-hmm. I think that there can be another vision that we can do.
I just wanted to follow up on you say why you're saying, why I voted for MCAS, even though I have to leave the party. Our district's not ready to set up for park. We need a lot more of technology and a lot more having it moved into, I mean, I have to have it flow. So that's why I voted for MCAS. So I think MCAS is better than I think park would probably be more addressed, seems to address more of what we need.
Sure. Yeah, what I was thinking about was great, because Pam said one side of the thing that I was thinking about saying. And I think the other half of that is, I mean, I think for me, it's fairly obvious that, first of all, let's just start with the no is the answer to the question. And it's fairly obvious that the argument about that is pretty straightforward, that if either the Common Core or Park were really educationally preferable to what people are currently doing for curriculum or for assessment, they wouldn't have to be mandated. You go into all the arguments about why they don't aren't better than other available curriculum. That's not to say that we couldn't do a better job of educating and we couldn't do a better job of assessing, but that these are this particular method is the best way is pretty wide open to debate, I think. So then the question then is, okay, so if that's true, if the answer to those questions is no, well then what? And there's sort of two parts. I mean, you know, the school committee is a creation of state government. Right? And So is the requirement at the moment of the MCAS, and so would be in a year from now the requirement of the Park test. And so the school committee, you know, it's not a freestanding independent thing at all. And so it's kind of limited in terms of what it can do as a school committee relative to any of these questions. Mm-hmm. So the discussion, well, is the school committee for or against these things? It has value, but it's rhetorical value, symbolic value, but it's not going to change. The school committee doesn't have the power to decide these things. And so I think that's the part, is I think that clearly who does have the power to decide these things is the state government. And they are feeling a little pressure with money and whatnot with the federal government. So that's really where the focus needs to be, and that's where, again, back to sort of what the school committee thinks matters, but it matters in terms of its, you know, rather, it's not like a power relationship with the state government at all. It's more of a maybe persuasive, hopefully, possibly persuasive.
the second part of the problem is that they do attach a financial characteristic to the whole idea. I would think that the Northampton School Committee would find it difficult to take the end of the to excuse Northampton from something at the risk of losing any kind of funding for our education. Now, if it were a bigger group of people, if it were a conversation in which we could have powered the super soldiers rather than taking a stand,
I know that there's funding tied to Common Core and to high state testing. And my question is, what is the dollar amount? So much of our resource goes into preparing for these tests. And if that's the dollar amount that's coming in, if we said, and this is a, you know, if we say, you know what? No, thank you. You keep your money. And we're going to, you know, we're going to do what we want is best for our young people. I mean, why couldn't we sort of even look at that as an option to really sort of look? And I would want to see, what are those numbers? Is that money coming in? Is it immediately going out so that we can prepare and spend time for these tests? Is it a complete loss? You know, so I think that's the question that I think sort of going on.
Federal government
is
every dollar of my tax dollar, so that's not a lot. I love to think about feeling the sentiment and then putting large groups of people. Because I think people across the state are very, now it's consistent. And I think it's time to get message out at the local level as we're pushing the most.
You know, Chapter 7 from the R at the very bottom, and you get almost 70,000. That 70,000 represents a teacher, or maybe two teachers, depending on the teacher. I do still want the 2 cents per dollar back to our education, and I do want the state also. I think what we need to work on is funding our mandates, and also the timing of things. We have four different... They want teacher evaluations implemented. They want retail. Put under the fourth one right off the table. We have four things that we have to implement right now, and that's also very difficult. Usually it takes anywhere from 3 to 5 years for one thing to get implemented well, and probably we're asking four things of us now to do. But so I think that needs to be looked at, and I think that we really should go after our state for unfunded mandates. I mean, they tell us what we have to do, and then we don't put any money to it. You know, and as far as the state, us going to the state, I don't really think it's a state thing. I think it's a federal. You know, PARC is turning into a federal way of all the different states being able to say, this is where we all are. So I don't think that Massachusetts is going to say, go and then stand up. I think that we should start to think that we might be able to get more like funding and mandates. I want every penny of the money. Because as a teacher, it's very hard. We're having to decide what we're cutting and whether or not we're keeping our classroom budget. So, I mean, if even if, you know, $100,000 out of a $28 million, that's a lot of money still. I voted against the budget 2 years ago because of $5,000 that I didn't think we should have left there. And we had priorities for teachers that needed it. I mean, it's really hard to figure out where to go and what to do with the money. And I think we need every single thing. And I wouldn't want to set up and make a statement, you know, a philosophical statement.
I was going to say a few things. I think the school committee has said many important things related to this, but I wanted to just, for people maybe that don't know, and I hope those on the PSAC will correct me if I misspeak, but I wanted to say something about the Common Core and what the Common Core actually is. The Common Core was a set of national standards that was of interest to Obama and Secretary of State for Secretary of Education Duncan. And it was actually the National Governors Association that was charged with writing the standards, that decided to write the standards. But standards have been around for a long time. And we've always had good, actually strong standards in Massachusetts. Standards that have been written in part by professional organizations like the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics were the first set of professional standards, and they kind of became the roadmap for other professional organizations. So standards have been around for a long time. This idea that we should have a set of national standards so that we can have national kinds of comparisons is a relatively new idea. One of the things that concerns us is where the funding is coming from for this. So who is actually driving it? And the Common Core, the writing of the Common Core has been funded primarily by the Gates Foundation. That the Gates Foundation has spent in excess of, some people estimate, $2 million funding the development of the Common Core. So I think we have to think about, you know, who is driving this sort of national movement. Then the PARC testing is a testing that's connected to the Common Core. And one of the things that happens when you have this set of national standards, and they're actually adopted individually by states. The states were not required to adopt them, but there was extra points in getting raised to the top money if they did adopt them. So that you had a little better chance of getting raised to the top money if you had the Common Core standards. The PARC testing, then, is one of two tests that have been developed by groups to test the Common Core standards. And with the PARC testing, it's been written by the Pearson Corporation. And one thing that's kind of interesting about this new sort of everybody's on the same page nationally is it creates this enormous market for for-profit corporations to come in and provide tests and curriculum and services and training for a textbook and all kinds of, you know, this multi-billion dollar industry where then a large percentage of this really sort of, you know, precious amount of money we have doesn't just go into purchasing textbooks, but goes into profits for corporations that are providing textbooks. So it's this kind of profit-driven, corporate-driven interest behind the Common Core and the Park that is of concern to CSAC. And the other thing I'm not sure people, everybody knows, is what we're talking about. We're talking about high-stakes testing. Because I think, you know, I've been a teacher. Assessment is an important part of being a teacher. Teachers need to know how kids are doing. They do formative and summative assessments all the time. But high-stakes testing is testing that is punitive in some way. So the most, I think, dramatic way that it's punitive is the way children do on testing reflects on what you think about the teacher. But what we know is that the way kids do on testing is tied to economics of the children. And we are very, very clear that that's the case. Children who have lower income levels don't do as well in standardized testing as wealthier children do. And so to tie teacher evaluation to children's scores, to tie the evaluation of schools to children's scores, to tie graduation to some children's scores, is just something that doesn't seem to promote the mission of North.
How do you think the current data-driven environment of high-stakes testing and teacher evaluation is impacting the teaching and learning that happens inside the classroom, including the quality of the curriculum, the role of creativity in the arts in our schools and in our children's lives, and the relationships between students and between students and teachers?
This to me is a little bit more complicated. So we have two questions. One is the data-driven environment of high-stakes testing and teacher evaluation. And so the first part I think is really helpful. We see that in some of the video. When we take the stress of our students, I'm also a teacher, so I'm in a public high school, and I really see the effect of students profoundly. And it's inhumane, and actually, that's really my work in terms of high stakes testing. I can't do that enough. And I think really great teachers don't want to do that, but they want their students to succeed, so it forces them to push out the creativity. But it seems like my teachers are doing a really wonderful job in trying to adapt. So that's like the second. And then for me, the teacher evaluation, to be really frank, is more complicated. I don't like that it's associated with any student textbook. Students should be part of the equation only insofar as an evaluator is looking in the classroom and students can participate in the class or in the unit or whatever, engaged. The student testing, again, it should not be part of it. There's too many other variables, you know, kind of poverty, special needs, trauma, with that said, for people who don't know, there are four standards that teachers are being evaluated on: curriculum, instruction, professional culture, professionalism, and family and community. And then teachers have to be proficient in the first two, and they have to show evidence in numbers 3 and 4, which is professionalism and the family and community relationship. And they have to be proficient in one of those things. I think, and then there are 33 elements in that. So the positive thing about it is it shows the public, who I hope will be becoming engaged, how many unbelievable things people are doing in our community. And it's amazing. The negative thing is that it's taking a lot of time for teachers, and I think that it should be used in theory as a tool to help teachers see what they're doing really well, and it should be a tool for an evaluator to say, hey, you're struggling here, let's help you. was it complicated for me and like someone has a petition around, is it not so easy to feel it could be harmful. And that's where I think any evaluation system is could be harmful. So that's just the nature of that. Most people can question if you want to think about it. So I think any evaluation tool could be a tool that could be harmful. The other part of this is that that's all I'm going to say. It's mixed for me.
And I think with this question, I don't really want to answer this question. What I would like to hear from this question is I'd like to hear from the students and hear their story and their experiences with sitting in these tests, preparing for these tests. You know, thinking about, you know, going to bed the night before knowing that they have to take this test and that it's not, it impacts their life, but it also impacts their school and their community and their teachers, you know. So that would really be, you know, a big group that I would like to hear from. I think it would be really powerful for us to hear their stories. Intriguing and exciting and fun the classroom is. It doesn't matter how
potential for every day as he goes into the classroom and is trying to teach what from the lesson plan every day that they step into. And now, but you've got, right of students in front of you. Sadly, we don't control our raw materials in the way prior industry does. We can't cut our costs the way prior industry does. We can't, change a lot of things. We have no control. So we have to make do with what we've got in the worst case, and then we try to make it better by the end of that day, and the next day, and the next day, and hopefully at the end of the year, they will learn what we might teach them. But, as far as teacher evaluation, I think that having a peer come in and evaluate may or may not look right. Having a supervisor come in and evaluate may or may not look right. Having rigid standards and way too many of them, 30 different, things in each section may not work right either. I don't know the answer either. I don't know the answer, but I see a lot of concerns about the part of it that I don't know how to fix. But I want to stop short of demonizing everything that's being put to us. I don't think it's all them. I think it started with reasonable intent.
And I'll pick up on that because I think that's a very important point, is that we all want our kids to do well in school. And then we say, okay, well, how do we know our kids are doing well in school? And that's the question we're all trying to ask ourselves. But in this question, the second question, the first one, there's a lot of stuff packed into those questions. It's a very complicated question, so therefore the answer is complicated. But the part that struck me about this question is an essential irony for me, and I'm sure for other people too, is that we talk about creativity. What does it mean that creativity is kids? Well, I think embedded there is I don't think anybody's going to say it's helping the creativity of kids. So it's hurting the creativity of the kids because it's time spent on preparing for a test. But again, I think Lisa makes the point very well. Tests in and of themselves aren't bad. I know there's at least one AP teacher in this class. If you're teaching an AP class, there's a standardized test at the end. And that's pretty important for the kids in the end. You've got to get through that test. So to get back to the creativity piece for a moment, in my day job, I work at a private high school, and we have a lot of international students who come to school in the United States precisely because the school that they're used to are too focused on rote testing. So they want to come here to get more of the creativity that's embedded in our system. And we're trying to get that creativity out in some of them. So my son, who's, as Ms. Gerald reminded me, graduated next year from Jackson School. He's telling me about all of the schools that are filling impact. And I think Glenn does a really good job here at Jackson School of managing kids' stress in a person. Maybe sometimes it's stupid because Ellen will say, well, I finished really quickly, and then I just kind of put my head down for a while and took a nap. And then I wonder, he's learning things when he's doing that aren't really intended on how the test is supposed to work. So maybe there's a little bit of positive emotion. I don't know. I guess what I'm saying is I hope that all the creativity that we stand by, I don't think it's candy, because of the teachers that we have here who do a fantastic job. And I'm trying to figure out how how do you thread the needle between an assessment that's going to say, yeah, the school is doing a good job for all of our kids, and one that doesn't say that when they're done, they're all going to be the same kids, because that's not what we want. That's not much of an answer, just make sure.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's
all right.
I remember before we had Park, we had Common Core, we had teacher evaluations, and we had the retest. I was thinking about that earlier. We didn't have to train all those people. We didn't have professional development for the teachers. They pulled out of so much professional development time each year to keep teaching and trying to get new things in, like the ELL standards or the teacher evaluation. I think, like I said earlier, I think we really need to with the four mandates that are expected at the same time are all expected to implement a disability in a short period of time. One of the problems, too, the education system doesn't really work that way. I mean, it's a long, drawn-out process of government. So I just worry about the professional development side of it. Always having to learn more with all these mandates, and instead of just being able to focus on, you know, the park testing, or just being able to focus on teacher evaluation, which divides up their time. And I'm not sure what it would do for the creativity in the classroom. I'm always been against MCAS because I feel that MCAS was really rote. It goes back to that idea of rote assistance. But PARC, I don't know yet, and I'm not sure anyone really does, but it's a post help kids become more critical thinkers. And with critical thinking, a lot of times does come self-creativity. So I'm not sure if it's going to be that or not.
You know, I think, again, people may have mentioned many things that we care about. They're just sort of four central ideas that I think, or four central things that I think happen in a very data-driven environment. One, that perpetuates this idea that schools are failing. One of the things that's happening with the rollout of the park nationwide is that kids are just simply not passing. And in fact, the National Governors Association put out a little blurb that said, you know, you can expect that your scores will drop about 43% in terms of who's proficient. Well, in Massachusetts, about 56% of third graders are considered proficient or higher in English language arts. So we can anticipate that we'll have 11% of our kids that we see as proficient. That simply doesn't make any sense to me, that we only have 11% of our kids as proficient. So it perpetuates this notion that the schools are failing. It is demoralizing to teachers because, you know, teachers who work with the most challenging kids then are punished by the way the data is being used. And I think that the problem that everybody's mentioned that we feel concerned about is that it turns classrooms into test prep factories. And the more challenging the children are, the more this is the case. So it's the most true for kids of color, for poor kids, for English language learners, because they have the most difficulty with the testing. And then finally, it simply creates a market, a big market, for for-profit corporations to provide testing, provide test evaluation, to score tests, to provide materials. And certainly there's always been money that's been used for those kinds of things. But the level of investment and the money that's spent, both in the preparation for testing and the testing itself, is astronomical.
So in the interest of time, we do have a third question, which is, would you as a representative on the school committee consider taking formal stance against the high stakes testing that's implemented in Common Core and PARC? And, you know, again, if you feel comfortable answering, I think you would be able to have said as much, but saying yes, no, or undecided.
As a representative of feedback, so what we had in mind when we asked that question, there are school committees across the state
you can handle the advocacy. You know, as a member of the school committee on a larger committee, would you be in favor of the formal standards?
I don't think I would. I think there's more standards to take on other things. Of high kids testing, we tried that with MCAS before, and it didn't really matter all the amount of time doing the MCAS. You know, the law had people know against MCAS and all those things. It didn't really matter, so the reason I kind of say no is because I feel like I would just be batting the head against the wall.
So, I like what Steve has done, but it's like it's incumbent upon us. I think it is really important, and that's fun for me. But I think it's one of the most important things that we do is this record discussion now. But I love, and what Lisa said is bringing more people together to collaborate or other. I think that is, to me, a more powerful thing to do. And I think even more importantly, is getting the public behind it and educating people. And I actually think that we can do something. So I'm actually hopeful about that. And I'm not, and I want to be really clear, I'm not opposed to standardized testing necessarily. I think they're useful. And the one difference that I'll say about AP that makes part difference, I teach AP, and I test my students all the time, and I know what they're doing, and I know how they're doing. And then I get this AP test, and they take it. And then the next year, I find out that their scores, and I get real specific things about what items they didn't do well, they did do well, and then finish my teaching. And that is really useful, but it's combined with all these other tests that I've given them, and then in grade. So it's okay. I mean, the college can do both of those things. And so it's not just this one thing that, it's not the high stakes. The tests are really important. It's all teachers can tell you, imagine, some capacity, whether it's formative or summative. And to reiterate, what Lisa said, I think is just brilliant. I think we should really be collaborating and looking at what we're doing at this moment.
Well, and we knew who amongst our colleagues teaching and who wasn't, and who could teach and who needed support to teach better, and who wasn't interested in teaching better. So I think one of the things that I question is how much money is being spent on something that is 100%, no, I would say 90% useless, and what could that money be doing to help figure out how a professional standard could be implemented, you know, how supervisors could evaluate and have teeth behind those evaluations to teachers who, you know, aren't teachers. What could be done with that money that's being spent creating the test that gives us very little information? If we knew that it was really informative, it would be very different. But the lack of information, the data, I love what you said about the fact that, okay, we know all of a sudden, we know the result, you're going to get 49% lower. Why bother having the test then? Just give us that score and give us the money. We save it. So it's nothing. So when you talk about the industry, is this industry designed to, like the Wizard of Oz, and it's just a question of how to get the education community to break up that power, and that I don't know.
I wanted to speak to that idea of whether the high-stakes testing or the testing itself is informative. I have a daughter who's in special education. I refused or opted out of MCAS this year because I knew that she would not benefit from taking that test. What she benefits from and what I benefit from is the information that I get from her special education teacher and her general ed teacher through email communication, through meetings, through actual discussion, through looking at her homework and seeing where she needs help, poking her with her homework. That's just meaningful to me. This test has no bearing on her IEP at all and what I advocate for her as her parent. She did not meet her goal last year. She was 10 points below in both ELA and math. And she cried through the test and she struggled. And I will not put her through that. Because it's mandated from someone else who I absolutely have to. So I know what she needs, her teachers know what she needs, and that's really smart. And that's what we think is the best useful information. I trust her teachers very much.
As a teacher, we have this curriculum. We don't need the Common Core to tell us how to teach. We are complex, intelligent people, and we already have this framework in Massachusetts for doing that. And we don't need, I don't need standardized testing at teachers at the elementary level because we have really good quality assessments already that are useful. I mean, I don't need to find out next year how much to put on the MCAS in grade because I don't have them anymore. I mean, I can do some of the IDEA classes, but, you know, we have beautiful reading assessments. We have great math assessments. We have great assessments. And it's useful because that's how we become better at our jobs. We are using those rich assessments. And that's data. That's data. That's really good data. Mm-hmm. It's qualitative, useful data. So we are data-driven, but it's useful data. And the last piece I want to say is that I think it's criminal to do either MCAS or any standardized testing in the Chinese standards. Mm-hmm. It's not designed for any standards. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you went to China and they gave you a standardized test in Chinese, imagine. So that's wrong. Mm-hmm. They should not be making that test. That is wrong.
I just have 2 points that I think are really important. So one critical and top one is that implementation, because that's where you have most people, right? The way you choose to implement the Common Core standards, which are not curriculum, they're just objectives and goals, and that you can go about them any way you want. Northampton has a lot of control over that. The teacher evaluation system, the way to interplay between staff and administrators, staff and supervisors, can be locally implemented in a way that feels good to people, and you can kind of control that. So I think that's really kind of important. The other thing I think is kind of important for the community, though, too, is to make sure that we look clear on the definitions. When we say things like Common Core and Core, we kind of throw them together a lot, and people just lay them right on top of each other. You know, we've got to have to be careful because they are two separate entities. And just as like point of full disclosure, I was on the review committee for the ELA framework when we advised it from 1993, and the revision that we put out was super, super close to what ultimately the Common Core put out. So, so just sort of keep some of that in mind. But I think for community members who aren't teachers or educators or highly invested in the schools, some of this is just, it all blends together, and so it's hard to make, to sort of state your opinion and be part of the conversation if you're really not clear about what it all means. And the idea is to sort of include everyone in the community, everyone. And so, you know, when you look around who's here and you wonder how many people are representing what parts of our community are actually in this room right now, participating in the conversation, and how do we broaden that to make sure we're hearing kind of everyone's voice on that. So,
I am in my third year as a psychologist. I'm currently entering the high school. Our middle school did elect to do the park this year, and I am just watching the most stressed system I've ever seen in years. The rate of kids with anxiety disorders, gastrointestinal disorders, I mean, just regular ed kids, regular ed kids, it doesn't matter. Our population is fairly middle class. Most kids have what they need, you know, not all, but for the most part. We get most kids over the bar, the young class, and the way the test works, you know, they're developed in this world, and people follow the left side of it and the right side of it. In order to get everybody over the bar, the bar keeps flowing, so it's not even really, if you talk to psychometricians, it's not even a good test in that way, because each time you take the MCAT, when you look at the 240, they take up one more hard test. So eventually, we get most of the kids over the line. It doesn't really tell you what it is you're looking to know. So I'm mostly concerned about the mental health of kids, social emotional development, the kinds of things when you talk about, you said something about what you have to prove that kids learn from the very day. They learn community, they get connections with their teachers. Those are really valuable things that can never be managed in a kind of class. What happened this year with the middle school kids who ended up doing the MCAS and then the FARC is then the teachers still have to teach their curriculum. So they're cramming these kids to the very last day. We're going to next week, and everybody's just so stressed because teachers are expected to teach a certain amount of curriculum as well. And we have good teachers, and we do a good job, that's good. We have good assessments, and we have good kids. And when I first started in the field, our professional development really dealt with the whole child, and now it's mainly about data, all of it. And so I don't even hear about the whole child anymore. Social emotional development is not even part of the discussion. So that's one thing.
So just in relation to your point, which I like, I think it's interesting that when the MCAS started, this is the year 2014 when everybody was supposed to be proficient. And I guess that's, you could say that's a failure, and so surprise, surprise, we come to the test. And a lot of money was spent on MCAS, and now we're going to spend money on this test. And what is going to be the benefit of it? Maybe PARC is better, I don't know. So that's a question for me. And as far as Common Core, I can't say I can comment with any authority, but I'm a music teacher, and I recently went to the Allstate convention, the music convention, and I made a point of going to a workshop on Common Core, and there was a guy who presented, who I really respect, I've seen him present a few times, and he said, it sounds good to me, and I said, at the end of the presentation, I said, I just don't get how you can evaluate creativity or expression. And he said, well, yeah, you really can't, but maybe you can evaluate the process. And then my next question is, well, I didn't ask it, I was thinking, well, which process is the one that you're evaluating? You know, how many processes are there to be creative? And creativity is now supposedly the top thing that we're striving for, and the Bloom's taxonomy, they changed that, and now creativity is number one. And, so Common Core can't can evaluate creativity that I'm not sure it's good.
I'm thinking about the my heart goes out to you. I'm proud of you. Thanks for standing up and saying there's no desserts. And that's what I want to say. Our job is to honor children. And that's what I do for my teacher. So that's what I want to say tonight. I think high stakes testing is robbing our children of childhood. Being a kindergarten teacher now and being a preschool teacher earlier on, I just see that they're going to push, push, push. I'm struggling this year more than ever to make a balance for my children so they have everything. That's the focus. It's really hard, and I feel like sometimes it has to be at a cost. So we have to decide, do we want to send them to reading at a high level, or do we want to wait until they're in third grade when they're all going to be reading at that level? So I would just ask you to think about that from your heart to honor children and where they are.
Well, I have a question that I'm sort of thinking about comments that you made. Several different times during the evening. So, what people can do, well, it's not necessarily the right thing. But I'm curious about the question that we posed, the coalition posed, about the committee saying, yes or no, we don't want peace. Okay? So, you raised this earlier in the evening to point out, what does it mean fiscally for a community school if you say no to tests? Is it the 2 cents on the line? Is it 75? And I don't know the answer to this question. I'm not asking the question that I don't think anybody else in the room does. But at what level as a community are we willing to say, we'll give up that 2 cents on every dollar so that we don't have to do these special tests? And we'll find another way to do something that works better for all of us. Is it 2 cents on a dollar? I don't think it's 98 cents on a dollar. Where's the threshold where we'll say, we're willing to take this level of this company in order to jettison if we said we're not administering the tests, how much money does that really mean? And are we willing to take the tests? I have a friend who teaches at this high school in Seattle, and he read about 2 years ago, and the teacher effectively said, we're not doing the tests. And the administration says, you've got a whole lot of jobs. They didn't get the test, and they didn't use their job, and something started there because they stood up and did that. So I'm wondering what our cost is. What are we going to put as children?
I'll start off with me or behind you. Sorry. I'm not a resident of Northampton, so I'll start with that disclaimer. I know people in Northampton, I've got teachers in Northampton, and I've heard a lot of comments made tonight that just reinforce my positive feelings about your school system. I'm intensely interested in the questions tonight, which is why I came. And the one I'd like to talk about, because I don't think we have much control over solving the learning gap by choosing between MCAS and PARC. I think everybody is pretty well expressed that those reward children who started reading with their families when they were tiny, whose writing skills are developed in school but also outside of school, mm-hmm. who have structure at home, who do their homework, etc. But I do think that there are skills that can be measured. You talked about creative thinking and creative process. I think that there are skills under headings like creativity, adaptability, collaboration, personal responsibility, leadership, that if those were part of the curriculum, if those actually got measured as part of the student report card, you would automatically see the learning gap begin to close. Because there are students who have those skills, but it doesn't show up on MCAS, it doesn't show up on their report card, even though teachers would be able to anecdotally say, I love having a student in my class because, and yet nowhere in the grade book does any of that get reported. And I was in education 42 years, and I did not score those things either. I'm a huge fan of doing it now, and I'm working to help schools do that. Because I think it's very capable of being accomplished over a long period of time. You can't solve it in a year. The way they threw the PARC exam out there and said, here's the Common Core, and a couple of years later, you haven't even figured it out yet, but here's the PARC exam, which is based on the Common Core, your kids are going to fail. Get used to it because, you know, we know that's going to happen. We haven't even field tested. And then, and we're going to build teacher evaluation and student graduation rates around it. That's a question you've dealt with. That's a difficult question. But I think if you're just talking about the learning gap, and what can we do for students that really, really care about things like creativity, under that heading, there are measurable skills. And teachers, one at a time, can find things in their curriculum that they're already doing where they could say, I could measure that. Not with an 88 or a 61, but with, you're a beginner, you're getting better, you're showing real confidence and competency in this, that rewards kids who aren't getting any strokes at all, or the strengths that they do have, just because they don't read very well, and they don't do enough homework. So they're doomed to fail the MCAS, and they're probably doing not too well in school on their homework and their grade reports. That's the part that really interests me, and I've heard people tonight talk about that. And it goes back to the root question, how do we solve the learning gap? How do we make student achievement better in our town? I think that's a big part of it. And those skills aren't taught just in the classroom. Kids learn those skills on teams. Those coaches should be participating in this. The theater program in your town is amazing. What skills are they learning there, and shouldn't you be getting feedback, not just from teachers, but from those leaders as well? And that, you have community programs, or even outside of the school, where kids are learning those skills. And you'd like to bring the whole community together if you could find a way to do that. That's my current interest in life. And I hear a lot of people saying things like that tonight, so I just wanted to emphasize it.
I just wanted to talk
about
here.
But I've spoken already, okay, so I want to make sure.
So we'll go back over here, and then we'll come back.
Okay. So along with that, I think it's really important to know that kids, I mean, I think we all know this, which is the problem with high school testing, is kids' brains develop at all different levels. And I know many a case where a kid is flunking out of high school, in fact, the guy that designed the rover for Mars dropped out of high school, he joined a rock and roll band, he walked home one night and looked at the stars and got intrigued with astronomy, went to community college, and went to MIT and got into college. So I think that's the other really problematic thing of the way we're doing collaborations now, is we're not taking into account that, you know, some kids aren't going to get there until they're 20. You know, they're reading, they're going to get into reading when they're 20, not when they're 13, 14, 15, and so those kids are going to use a little bit of text, but that doesn't say they're not going to go to MIT at some point in time. And I think that's why it's so dangerous to base high school graduation, which we know high school diploma is going to be really important, on, you know, standardized testing, and that we don't kind of look at the whole kid and where they're at, and that, you know, not everybody's going to, at 18 years of age, everybody's brain is not going to, may not be able to do it. So I think that's the other really important thing to consider in terms of what we're doing.
So I just want to go back to what you were talking about in terms of, like, where is the parameter that you can draw? Even before we ask that question, we didn't really have the sense of, like, probably about a year. And the school issued a diploma in Massachusetts. If someone
Can I say this? We had a superintendent when the MCAS first came out who protested and said, I'm not going to, Dr. Erickson, a wonderful man, I'm not going to withhold any diploma if people don't pass the MCAS. And they threatened to take away his.
But part one is to address that, and I think that they're always going to threaten everything, right? I think at some point you have to get offended if what happens, because that's always a threat, and the risk is that parents are going to have to do consequences, and then you have to think about, and I think that's the concept that I'm talking about, where is that? But I wanted to speak to some other things, which is, I guess some of what I'm hearing is, and maybe it's because we need to know more about the Common Core, because it's like, Common Core maybe is okay, it's the standard, because PARC is what's really bad. And I kind of want to come back and say, actually, I think the Common Core speaks too, and part of it connects back to what everyone is saying about developmental appropriateness. Mm-hmm. And so the PARC test measures the Common Core standards. Those standards were developed, and then there's a whole other piece we could talk about another time about how the standards were developed, not by teachers, but by mostly corporations sat around that table and developed those standards, not teachers. Teachers were able to provide feedback way later on the process, and that feedback was, nobody ever knew whether or not that was taken into consideration. But the standards, a lot of early childhood educators and other people across the country have come out and said those Common Core standards are responsible for pushing everything down, that we're seeing that push down and decimating play in kindergarten, for example. So yes, the PARC tests are kind of where we're focusing, like these are evil, but they're measuring the Common Core standards. So it's not like, for sure, as a teacher, I could try to sort of do my own thing. It's not like I have to take a curriculum, although that's coming because a lot of districts are buying curriculum and being sold by Pearson. Mm-hmm. So that's coming too. So that actually is happening. But say my district didn't say, here's the curriculum you have to follow. You still have to follow these standards, which are intensely problematic and have been found to be intensely developmentally inappropriate. So
it's 8:29. If you are interested in knowing a whole lot more, I've got some flyers and the organizational and jobs like that. And I don't plan on responding, but close to 50,000 members of jobs, which is actually in other countries. And we're quite too fast. DAT means bad attitude. But we include, invite parents and community members in our fight against all of the things that we talked about tonight. We have a website, and we have a very, very active Facebook page. And so I'm going to leave the flyer here. But if you don't get one, just go online to Bad Ass Teachers. And you'll find out a lot of things. We are going to have a rally in March in D.C. on July 20th. And we are going to be making a big media event. So
what's the rally for? What are you rallying?
We are rallying at the Department of Education. We're bringing our message to Washington. That we want local control of the schools. We have members in every state, and we are not, Northampton is not alone, and that's really important. I have conversations with educators and parents across the country every day on all of these topics, and so I encourage you to listen.
I just want to say really quickly, as a citizen, I really take a stance against, take a stance and say, okay, let's see what happens with this. This is a really crowded room. This is crowded. The people are very, very mad that we took the money away from the classroom and the teachers. And not that we owe the teachers the job, but we owe the students the teachers. So I just want to say that they did make that stance, that there's a lot of mad people.
Thank you.
regard to the conversation that we're going to continue and it's going to get broader and bigger. So please, you know, stay engaged and take the flyer and
there is a signage sheet.
Yeah.
Around. So
great.
Thank you.
Thank you.